Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Third down and eight at the 11 of Michigan State. Back goes Clifford. Blitz coming. Throws in the end zone. Wide open. Theo Johnson. Touchdown, Penn State. A 90-yard drive for the Nittany Lions. Under center is Clifford. Quick toss. Lambert Smith throws it downfield. Wide open. Theo Johnson got it to 15. 10-5. Touchdown, Penn State. Keandre Lambert Smith. They set it up perfectly. Sean takes it. Back to pass. Pump fakes. Looks in the end zone. Warren reaches up. He's got a touchdown. Penn State. He recovered the fumble and the punt. He gets rewarded with the touchdown. And the Nittany Lions with a 20-3 lead. Thorne takes it back to pass. Blitz coming. Pressure hit it. Down he goes. Back at the 50-yard line. Abdul Carter led the charge. Clifford looks it over. Fourth and two. Takes it back. Throws near side. Singleton to the 10, to the 5. Touchdown, Penn State. And in the clutch, the Nittany Lions goes 75 yards. Chop Robinson in at defensive end. Back goes Thorne. Pressure. Being chased. Rolls out. Throws it down the near side. And intercepted by Kalen King at the 35-yard line. Allen is to the right of Clifford, too far side. Play action fake. Sean loads it up. Long and deep down the middle is Keandre Lambert-Smith. He's got it. Touchdown, Penn State. They go for the bundle after the takeaway. Game, set, and match, Nittany Lions. And they'll take a knee here. They don't have to. 10 seconds left. It's over. The Nittany Lion football team, unranked in the preseason, now 10-2 on the year and ranked in the top 10. They beat Michigan State on November to remember for Penn State as they put together four spectacular November performances.
Oh, that they did. Good afternoon, everybody. It is the Steve Jones Show on a victory Monday, the final one of the regular season, at least until we get to bowl season, hopefully. Matt Catrillo here with you. Steve will soon be there in the Sunbury Motors Studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Ford Kia Hyundai, great selection of new and pre-owned inventory. And whether you are looking for a brand new car or a used car, the sales staff is there for you and not just there for the sale. And there's many awesome technicians ready to serve you in the fabulous service department. Whether it's the diagnostics, the inspections, all the routine maintenance, they're there for you for your current vehicle. And because SMC has such great customers going back and back again because of that Sunbury Motors guarantee, more awesome technicians are being sought for that service department in the quick lane, car light truck service, heavy truck service, body frame and alignment, and towing departments. So whether you're an experienced technician, an entry-level technician looking for your first job, or someone looking for a career change, they'd love to hear from you. Stop by in person, apply online at sunburymotors.com, or you can call Todd at 286-7746. All at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. And every Monday show, brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury, or go to purdyinsurance.com. Home, auto, life, business, motorcycle, you name it, they have it. They're the true pros when it comes to insurance matters. It's all at Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury, or go to purdyinsurance.com. Hope everybody enjoyed their Thanksgiving and holiday weekend. Obviously, with a Penn State victory on Saturday, it certainly sweetened the pot a little bit. We're good to be back in our full week back from Thanksgiving week, or Thanksgiving weekend, I should say. And today, we're keeping it going with the bang. We got Mark Wogenrich, SI.com, at 4:06 to recap the final game of the regular season, the tremendous win streak this whole month that Penn State football has had, some bowl projections. And I want to get to a story he had over, that just came out today in a second. And then we also have Bob Pompieni back with us, one of the best in the biz out of KDKA in Pittsburgh. Steelers-Colts tonight on Monday Night Football over on 100.9 The Valley. So he'll join us at 4:35. And tomorrow at 3:35, Eagles Radio Network's Glenn Macnow joins us. Recap the Eagles' wild win last night against Green Bay. And get ready for the Tennessee Titans next Sunday at the Link. Eagles 10-1 now on the year after the W last night at the Link. So getting back to, well, first let me go with the game real quick. First of all, I'm glad that there was common sense at Beaver Stadium for everybody cheering on Sean Clifford during Senior Day recognition. I figured it would happen. I figured what happened before the Minnesota game would just be a one-time thing. But you never know sometimes. And I'm glad common sense prevailed and Sean Clifford got what he deserved. And just to add on to this here, so the fourth down play that put Penn State back up by two scores in 28-16 to Singleton. You had Jack and Steve asking James Franklin about the play, and he said there's a package of plays in there. Well, that's because the quarterback recognized what was out there, switched to it, and boom, it worked to perfection. That is what a senior quarterback, and even in this case, a six-year quarterback, does, and why Sean Clifford has been the guy all year. Will Drew Aller know this a couple years from now? He might even know it next year. Yeah, of course. But in terms of this season, that's a play only Sean Clifford can make. With the game on the line to try and start to put Michigan State away, he audibles to that call in those package of plays out of the T formation on fourth down, and boom, it turns into a touchdown to go up 28-16. Penn State would seal it after that. That's Sean Clifford for you right there in his final home game. Just leaving it out there. And I can't say what the job that James Franklin has done. It is not easy. I don't care what your two losses are, period. But to go from unranked to the top 10 and you still have a fighter's chance at the Rose Bowl, that's a heck of a season right there. That's a heck of a coaching job. Yeah, you'd like some better results against the guys like Michigan and Ohio State. But even the Ohio State game, they were in that, and that was a winnable game. Maybe you probably should have won that game. But all in all, this Penn State program, like everybody else covering the team has said for a while now, is in very good hands going forward, and they have a lot of momentum to project them into next year, especially if they can get out with a bowl victory in whatever bowl they're in. Which leads me to this story by Mark Wogenrich as far as these bowl projections are. There is a caveat for Penn State to still get in the Rose Bowl, even if Ohio State is not in the college football playoff. All That's right, a different conversation. But there's right, still a chance there, Steve,
for
the Rose Bowl, which Wogenrich pointed out.
Yes, well, I'll get into that right out of the gate. You know, because, I mean, we could talk about the Eagles, but, you know, I mean, that was the most boring 40-33 game I've ever watched. That game was dull. No, I'm kidding. I thought it was actually a really good game.
I was going to say, my head's still spinning from that one last night.
It's a fun game. It was a fun game to watch last night. So Penn State, they start the season unranked. They end up 10-2. They're going to be ranked in the top 10. I think most of us, if we're gauging it, there's a good chance they're eighth tomorrow night. So let's go with conventional wisdom. Conventional wisdom says, and Jerry Palm is pointing this out, Cotton Bowl, Tulane, right? Okay. So that's the conventional wisdom. now let's get to the scenario you talked about with the Rose Bowl. The Rose Bowl, okay, let's make this clear. The scenario we're talking about, is if Michigan wins on Saturday. Because if Purdue wins, Purdue goes to the Rose Bowl, you know. They're the conference champion.
Right, right? Yes. And okay, important to so keep that in mind.
Okay. Right, so you have to remember that is a possibility out of the gate that you can't discount. All right. Michigan wins the game. So now we're doing this with the idea that Michigan wins the game. And say everything plays to form. TCU beats Kansas State, even though I'm telling you, Kansas State, that is that. Why are Herb Street and Fowler doing that game? Because that's the best game of the day, probably. I mean, they are doing that game, and they're not doing the ACC game. They're not doing, okay. Of course, Fox has the Pac-12, and they have, but they picked Kansas State TCU because it's they think it's going to be a really good game, and I agree with them. I think it is going to be a really good game. But say TCU wins. And Michigan wins. USC wins. It doesn't matter as much about USC. We'll get to that in a moment. And it plays out. And Ohio State is on the outside looking in, right? You are not obligated. Believe it or not, the Big Ten is not obligated to take the next team. Now, tradition is that they have done that. So let's be clear. The tradition has been that that is what they do. But they don't have to. And I'll read to you directly what the process happens to be. Okay. In what is known as a traditional Rose Bowl game year, the 2023 Rose Bowl game is contractually obligated to feature the Pac-12 Conference Champion and the Big Ten Conference Champion. The contract, known as a tri-party agreement, is between the Tournament of Roses, Big Ten, and Pac-12. All right. In both the Bowl Championship Series, which is now defunct, and the College Football Playoff, if the Pac-12 or Big Ten Conference champion was selected for the national championship or the national semifinals, that team is released by the Tournament of Roses, and the Tournament of Roses now selects a replacement team. In the past, that allowed teams such as Texas or TCU to play in the Rose Bowl. Now, however, in the College Football Playoff system, the Tournament of Roses may only select a team from its partner conferences, Big Ten, Pac-12. Should a team from the Big Ten or Pac-12 be selected to go to the College Football Playoff, the Tournament of Roses will traditionally select the next highest-ranked College Football Playoff team from that conference. So that would be, no matter what, it would be Ohio State, right? But then this sentence comes up. There is, however, a caveat to that clause in the contract. Oh. If the next highest ranked team is in a cluster of teams, meaning there is another team or teams from the same conference ranked within several spots of each other, and Penn State will be no fewer than three away, the Tournament of Roses will select the team from that cluster that will result in the best possible matchup for the Rose Bowl game. Here are the factors they take into account, in no particular order. One, the last time a team played in the Rose Bowl game. Ohio State played there last year. Penn State, 2016. Advantage Penn State. Head-to-head results. Advantage Ohio State. Regular season schedule, pretty much the same. overall record, you know, I mean, Ohio State does have that game with Notre Dame, but overall record, okay, slight advantage Ohio State. Opponents played, okay, about the same. Past playoff or bowl appearances and performance and historical matchups. So that is how it works. They get to pick. And they can literally pick anybody they want. But they would prefer to have it be one of the top two remaining teams, and usually it is the top remaining team. But there are two factors here. One, Ohio State played there last year. That does come into play. And two, C.J. Stroud has said that he would prefer not to play in a non-playoff game. He would prefer not to play in a game like that. I think that then becomes a factor.
Now, that I didn't hear. So this is definitely a very realistic possibility.
I'm just saying, just put it out there as a possibility.
Oh,
okay?
Yeah.
Again, what is conventional wisdom? Conventional wisdom is what? Let's remember, it's still conventional wisdom.
Yeah, Cotton Bowl.
Says the Cotton Bowl. But, again, as you know, I looked at none of this until the weekend. So, because I didn't, you know, people were asking me last time, I said, to be honest with you, I haven't really looked at it. And I haven't really looked at it until Sunday. I looked at it. You also know I hadn't really looked at rankings until Tuesday night last week for the first time. Really hadn't. I know it's, you know, people, oh, that's impossible. But believe me, it's very possible. All right, we do have Mark Wogenrich on the show today, right?
We do, at 4:06.
So we'll get Mark on to talk about. And we have Bob Pompeiani tomorrow.
Today. When,
oh, you sent this yesterday, so it's tomorrow. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll talk about the Steelers and the Colts.
Correct.
And then Justin King in the next half hour. So here's the story about Stroud. The Buckeyes are going to play in a New Year's Six game at the worst. True. Stroud is considered one of the best college quarterbacks in the country. True. Certainly has an NFL future. True. Perhaps he'll be invited to New York's Heisman Finals. We'll see. But will we ever see him play again wearing scarlet and gray? When asked that very question during his post-game press conference, Stroud could not give a sure answer, but his body language suggested he recognized that may not happen. Yeah, I can see the Tournament of Roses saying, we can't wait to see Kyle McCord. But again, it's their choice. And Michigan has to win first. Michigan has to win on Saturday night. That has to be part of the scenario. All right. So we'll take a break. Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Auto, home, life, business, RV, boat, motorcycle. They'll do everything they can to save you money. They will make sure you are fully insured. They are and they're great people. They're Bill, Craig, Adam, Summer, I mean, all of them. You know, Steve Engel, what a group all the way through. and happy holidays to all of them. They are terrific. Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai. Best in new inventory, all with great warranties. Great pre-owned inventory with the Sunbury Motors guarantee. And a fabulous service department to back it all up. And they're always looking for more technicians. I just want to make sure you're breathing after last night's game, right?
I am, yes.
Okay. Because, I mean, you know, Jordan Love's mere presence probably, like, scared the daylights out of you.
It didn't, but it was more of Aaron Jones. But I was more, it was more like, really, in the final couple minutes than I was panic mode. How about that?
I was trying to stay awake.
I was also trying to do the same thing.
It was like, it was getting late. I'm like, going, okay. Because when I get to tomorrow, I mean, do you realize tomorrow, from November 5th to tomorrow, tomorrow's the 12th game I will have done in 24 days.
Yeah.
So, you've been.
Like,
so, and I've been going. Right? So I'm like, okay. So I was, you know, so last night I was like, okay, come on. You can watch the fourth quarter of this. Yeah, and I was interested to see what Jordan Love would do. Yeah, you know, if anything. And he did all right.
Yeah?
Yeah, he did all right. He gave a good account of himself. And the we're talking about the college football playoff. The rankings will come out tomorrow night. Now, they'll come out when I'm doing the game. So I'll look at it and like, okay, it'll be on my phone. So I'll take a look at it then. But tomorrow, by the way, during the show, we will give you updates of the World Cup. It is quite simple. The U.S. wins, they advance. They don't win, which means even a draw, they don't go. Iran has the luxury of a draw in advancing. Iran can draw in advance. Iran can win in advance. The U.S. must win. If they don't win, they don't advance. And for a team that doesn't score a lot of goals, that's really a tough scenario. Very difficult. All right. Penn State just went through a 10-2 season. They won their final four games by a combined 175-40 over the final four games, playing their best football at the end of the year. And, of course, Matt played you the highlights when the show began. And we're very pleased to be joined by an old friend, truly outstanding for Penn State, Justin King. JK, great to have you back.
Steve, thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Nobody is going to sit here and know secondary play that we have in the show better than you. When you watch the Penn State secondary this season and the number of guys that are playing, what are we witnessing?
I mean, I think you're literally witnessing a generational group of DBs. I mean, Penn State for the past, 7-8 years have been putting some high-level defensive backs out when going to the NFL. You talk about Monty Oware up there, John Reed, and all these guys that are coming through now. It's extremely impressive and, you know, kind of birthed the idea of with the NIL opportunity to start lockdown you to brand around those guys because of how special they are from the depth, the position flexibility, and just sheer talent top to bottom, to be completely honest.
Well, what I find interesting is there are not many programs that could lose for a couple of weeks a guy like Joey Porter that you would consider a lockdown corner, right?
Right.
And when you're done with it, I mean, yeah, you missed him, but how much did you miss him because of the other guys?
Well, I mean, it says a lot, right? You got guys like Marquise Wilson, and then you say the other guys that step in, but just on the other side, you got a guy like Kalen King that puts up, you know, the type of numbers that he did this year with 18 passes, break up two picks, and just playing solid, just all-around football, right? He's like, he's jumping in from the secondary space, and, you know, we know what Jair and all those guys do. But they just make a lot of plays on the back end, and when you make plays, it covers up some of the, you know, mid-level passes or things that do happen. So that's been a common theme for Penn State this whole year, has just been an opportunistic defense, and the back end has been avoiding some opportunities for that to happen.
A guy like Zakee Wheatley came in as a corner, then they moved him to safety. Jair Brown at one point in his life was a corner, then ended up as a safety. What does corner play allow a guy to do when he then moves to safety and can see the whole field?
Well, that level of position flexibility gives you a chance to play more man coverages on the back end, have position flexibility so you can rock and roll the secondaries, whether if a blitz is coming one side, you can make the looks look the same way because you have two safeties that can cover, you know, slots or play center field and be able to tackle in the box. So when you're able to do that throughout the secondary, it gets really – it makes the job of a defensive coordinator extremely fun because they can send a lot of different things at the offense or the quarterbacks, and, you know, whether it's lining up seven at the line of scrimmage and dropping three out and still getting pressure, like, those things are able to happen because of the depth that you have on the back end. So, I mean, and that happens when you have safeties that can cover and tackle.
You're right.
So that's where, yeah.
Oh, exactly. So I'm going to ask you about Kalen King first, then I want to get to Jair. Kalen King, you know, obviously he's on the opposite side, and Joey had a, you know, when Joey was out there, he had a phenomenal year. He has all the ingredients of being a first-round draft pick. But Kalen King on the other side, as you mentioned, the 18 pass breakups, the importance of, because you obviously, you had great speed, you broke on the ball, you saw things, you believed it. What does it take for a corner when you're out there on the island to see and believe and react?
I mean, there's a level of confidence that comes with the position as a prerequisite for the position. But it's route recognition and understanding what the offense is throwing at you and be able to make those anticipated movements to be able to make a get into the interception zone or get into the passing lanes to make a pass breakup or get there to jar the ball loose. And Kalen's someone that has extreme high football instincts, and you can see it throughout a lot of plays that he makes, whether it's a lot of plays on bubble screens or plays at the line of scrimmage on quick passes, along with intermediate pass breakups and down the field pass breakups. He's just a very sticky corner. It's like a funny story with him. I'm just very fond of him because I remember when I left Penn State as a recruiting coordinator and go to the XFL, he was like one of the last group of DBs that I had to rank before I left. Like, I had, you know, the staff sent me some guys to rank, and he was one of my favorites. So I remember when he committed, I was no longer on the staff, but I was, you know, extremely excited for him to get him. So the thing that stuck out, what I'm trying to get to, the thing that stuck out is high school film was just his football instincts and his just feel for the game. And that really comes down to it when you're making plays on the defense, because they're not throwing you the ball. So you have to have a feel for what's happening around you to be able to trust your instincts and have all your athletic abilities even matter at the end of the day. So that's what it comes down to, and I think that's the biggest thing he has, is elite confidence and football instincts, which goes miles and tons at the corner position.
And that's what Johnny Dixon's also showing right now as the season is gone. But Joey Porter is obviously is it safe to say he has all the ingredients that you want in a first-round draft pick?
I mean, I don't know if anyone's ever seen Joey Porter. Like, you walk up on him as a – you know, I played in the NFL 6 years as a DB, and I haven't seen too many guys look like Joey Porter. And just the way he moves at the length that he has, the speed that he has, I mean, the sky is just the beginning for him. When you talk about playing DB, I think he's a lock for a first-round draft pick. Oh. I don't think it's like any – like debate on that.
Right. Yeah, I think he enhanced himself this year. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, yeah, as you know, there'll be certain plays that happen in a practice where you get to see something that maybe you don't see in a game. And, you know, there was one where he picked one off and he goes flying by. Justin, he left a vapor trail. I mean, the guy flat out can move.
No, I mean, just from the standpoint of how Penn State has been recruiting over the past year, just like, it was just length and speed. I think you see it show up throughout the defense, the offense, where you got guys like Abdul Carter jumping in there, freshman running backs that jump in and make an impact like they do. And, I mean, Joey Porter's one of those guys that came in when we recruited, and that was it, just elite athleticism, just the code of an NFL family growing up in there. So, like, nothing about the scene is too big for him either. So he's just really coming into his own, in my opinion.
And also should tell everybody a lot how hard he worked to make sure he could get back for Senior Day and play on Senior Day. He didn't play a lot, but he made sure he got back out there on Senior Day, and he worked hard to do it. Jair Brown.
Go ahead. Just to piggyback off of that point, I think that's something that you're right, Penn State fans should really respect. I mean, just at a time where he's about to be a first-round draft pick, to come back in a game that a lot would think that maybe is how meaningful it is for someone that may make a few million dollars in a couple months, to come back and play in a physical game against Michigan State says a lot about his character as a football player.
Right, and physical wideouts. Keon Coleman is a I mean, that's a basketball player playing wideout. I mean, that guy.
Absolutely.
I mean, we were talking about guy blockouts, everything. I mean, because I've already done a Keon Coleman basketball game in my career now. Jair Brown, when you are the quarterback back there as the safety, what does the mental side of the game mean to somebody like him to go along with the obvious physical gifts he brings to the table at the position?
I mean, it's everything at the safety position. I mean, you're truly the quarterback of the back end. You're seeing the whole field from both sides. And again, we talk about a lot of football instincts and anticipation. You know, a lot of times you're the last line of defense in the run game and the pass game. And so to be able to make plays and as many plays as he does, there's a lot of confidence and preparation that goes into that, right? The coach is putting him in a great position and him making the great plays because he's a student of the game. And just, again, he has a knack for the ball that's a little different, but he's always had high football instincts even coming out of Lackawanna. Just on how he played the game.
Yeah.
So,
well,
yeah, he's a treasure. He's a football player.
He was walking around the practice field. He was talking with Jack Ham, and he said, "I just want to drink this whole thing in." And then, of course, after the game, he's walking around Beaver Stadium. He said, "I just want to drink all of this in." I mean, I know in the world of NIL, and I'm going to run to the pros and things like that. There's still something about this place that is a magnet for these players, isn't it?
100%. I think it's a great piece that Penn State offers just recruits in general, because that level of attraction to the university, to Happy Valley, or everything that it comes in playing at Penn State is a little different, right? And it attracts a different level of football player and how they want to contribute to the program. And I think, I mean, you've seen it with Cliff and his brother racing at the end of the game,
yeah,
and things of that nature. And just a gratitude that you see from a lot of these seniors that are leaving that you don't typically see in college sports, where everyone's disgruntled about whatever the case may be, right? Transfer portal, money going around. But, like, just seeing a lot of level of gratitude coming from the Penn State seniors that I've seen is remarkably telling about, how they're running the show up there.
When you watch Abdul Carter, what do you see?
I see another number 11, you know what I mean? From a LeVar Navarro to a Micah Parsons, but he reminds me of Micah a lot. And not different type of football players. I actually think the level of physicality that he played with as a freshman is a notch up, to be completely honest. And just the way, again, we talk about football instincts, he's doing some special things that I don't think, I mean, everyone knows he's great, right? But I don't know if people understand how great he is from a football player standpoint, outside of just him being 6'4", how much he weighs and athletic, but just from a football standpoint and seeing that as a freshman, it's eye-opening. So, like, yeah, I think that's what I think about Abdul Carter. He's one of my favorites.
Yeah. As obviously a letterman, what did you think of a season where a team was unranked and has finished the way this one has?
Oh man, I think it's encouraging, right? And it's remarkable for the team to go on that rack, coming in, kind of counted out, and having freshmen fill in and key positions, and win a lot of games in a very Penn State fashion, right? Physical football, playing disciplined football, making plays across the field, and And again, a high level of talent coming out with a 10-1 season is nothing to bark at or scoff at. So I think I'm very excited for those guys, and you know, I think the future is bright. That's another thing. It's not just at the top of the mountaintop, and there's a whole bunch of seniors leaving. I mean, there's a lot of bright spots for the future with the talent on the team and the guys coming in.
And part of that talent, the two freshman running backs. When you see Singleton and Catron Allen, what's your evaluation?
Oh man, mature backs. Like they run like seniors already. And a lot of times when you get freshmen that jump into the scene, you know, they have a little bit of. They have a hesitancy to like hit the holes hard or run level of physicality. But the way that they play, you would think they've been in college for 2 to 3 years by now. You know, running through grown men, just the physicality level that they play with at a freshman level, just the patience they ran with, especially Keishon Allen, and the way that they balanced off of each other. A little bit of a lightning. Thunder and lightning, but mm-hmm. They're both extremely physical runners. So you can't really say that, you know what I mean? But I mean, it was a great thing to watch. A great 0-5 runner. So like seeing a lot of those 3-yard plays that turned to 6-7 leaky yards, that was like real encouraging to see. I mean, just from the Penn State fan, you know, the past couple of years not being able to get over 100 yards rushing, or you know, having the frustrations of like 3rd and 1 not being able to get it. There's a level of comfort knowing that, okay, these guys, they can take on that one extra unaccounted for blocker as freshmen, and the way that they did it was very impressive.
I miss talking to you on an everyday basis, so it's just great to have you on the show with me today. I appreciate it very much.
No, thanks for having me.
We were going to break down the Eagles game last night, but I said, do you want to do that? He goes, well, no, I want to talk about good teams.
No. The Eagles are a good team.
Oh, the 49ers are better. You're not making it. All right.
No, senor! No, senor! No, senor!
You know what's interesting, though? The Steelers, all kidding aside, so, okay, no more kidding here. The Steelers are playing a second-place schedule, and the Eagles are playing a second-place schedule. Now, obviously, the Eagles are a far superior team to the Steelers. But, man, they are not the same. The Steelers' schedule is tough. The Eagles' schedule, we'll point out, oh, you're, I mean, they can't help it. You play or you play. But their schedule's not difficult. That, to me, is bizarre. They're both playing second-place schedules, but one's playing an AFC second-place schedule while one's playing an NFC second-place schedule, and it's different. Hey, by the way, is Santa starting tonight?
Yes, debut show tonight at 6.
This is what, 82 years?
I'd have to check on the exact number, but I know we're well into the 80s now.
Isn't it unbelievable? It's one of the greatest things going.
It really is.
Talk to Santa, the Magic Radio. That is, to me, so cool. So cool. Now, Luke has 2 more years before he qualifies, right?
Yes. Yeah, it's 4 to 8.
There you go. And then little Mark has 7. It has 3 years.
Yep.
All right. And you will enroll them.
Oh, of course.
After after you're done yelling at them at football practice. We'll come back with more in a moment. Brought to you by Purdy Insurance on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
When car repairs get difficult.
Well, I just don't know.
Me neither.
We get good. Sunbury Motors. More than quality new and used cars, Sunbury Motors specializes in complicated auto repair diagnosis. They can handle intricate repairs and even complete auto body with service open Monday through Friday, 7 till 4. And Sunbury Motors has made simple repairs easy. Maintaining your vehicle is necessary. Finding the time to do it is difficult. Welcome to Sunbury Motors Quick Lane. Open 7 till 4, Monday through Friday. Just walk in or call ahead. Relax in their remodeled waiting room with Wi-Fi, beverages, and snacks. Will Sunbury Motors factory trained techs take care of your oil change, tire alignments, brakes, and inspections. Quick Lane, 6:30 to 6, Monday through Friday, Saturday, 6:30 till 2. Sunbury Motors, Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury. And Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. We take the out of auto repair.
For nearly 100 years, Purdy Insurance has been your locally owned, family-operated source for insurance products. With a staff of over 20 and partnerships with some of the industry's most trusted companies, Purdy has the experience and resources to get the job done. Whether you need personal, home, and auto, or complex business insurance solutions, Purdy will help you navigate through the process. Call today at 570-286-5855, or better yet, stop in their Sunbury office to see what Purdy Insurance can do for you.